Thank you. It's indeed a pleasure to be with you, and my thanks to Nelson and Baldomero for so kindly hosting. And I was intrigued by what Baldomero was saying about French linguistics from Quebec. And just a little side story, you know, the show The Simpsons, which is very popular here, never really took off in France when they dubbed it into French using the Parisian French. But then they decided to dub it into the Quebecois French, and then suddenly it became really popular. So I'd like to talk today about one of the big global development challenges, which is smoking. And I'll start by giving you my conclusions so that, you know, if you really don't pay any attention to the rest of it, you can at least get the gist of the key messages. So the first is that on current patterns, there'll be about 1 billion smoking deaths this century, including a large number, about 250 million deaths, just in those that are alive today in just a handful of countries. I'll show you evidence that prolonged smokers lose about a decade of life. That's the 21st century hazards. But that cessation by age 40, and preferably earlier, is ridiculously effective. And worldwide, the UN goal now, not the World Health Organization goal, but the United Nations goal of reducing premature deaths and smoking can only be achieved, in my view, by a substantial increase in taxation. And then, of course, there's the importance of monitoring the epidemic, which is dynamically evolving. So throughout the talk, I'm going to give you lots of numbers, and I apologize for that. That's what epidemiologists do, is give numbers, you know, and we're criticized as being number crunchers like accountants, and that's not quite fair. Accountants have more personality than epidemiologists. So let's start with the big numbers, which is what will be the deaths in this century on current smoking patterns? Well, we're in 2016, and in the first two decades of the century, there already are about 100 million deaths, roughly about 5 million a year. That will grow for reasons which I'll show you about the lag between consumption and increase, to something like 250 million in the 30-year time period between 2020 and 50. And then these deaths for the first half are mostly all in current smokers. Beyond 2050, the deaths we're talking about are very much in smokers that have not started yet. So overall, you get about 1 billion deaths. Now, that contrasts to the last century, where there were only, and I use the quote only in parentheses, that about 100 million deaths. And so the total is going to be 10 times bigger this century on current patterns. And it'll be much more concentrated in low and middle income countries. Most of the deaths in the last century were in high income countries. The deaths on current patterns are going to be in low and middle income countries. So let's put this into a bit of context about what smoking does for overall survival. Well, one way to look at it is very simply compare the 2010 death rates in Canada and by age, which is shown here, and the survival, which is shown here. And you see that in Canada now, and it's similar in the US, but very much different in parts of the US, 80% of those born can expect to reach age 70. Now, throughout this talk, I'm going to be talking about avoidance of tobacco deaths in middle age. And my definition of middle age changes as I grow older, but roughly, I'm going to talk about ages 30 to 69, or survival till 70. And you see now that 80% of Canadians born can expect to reach age 70. And that's still substantially different than in China, where it's about 65%, or in India, where it's about 50%. And the big movement that's occurring in global health is for countries to move to this trajectory where they basically have life expectancies like in Canada, meaning you have very low child mortality rates, very few children die in Canada, but you see in India still a substantial number of child deaths occur. And then in middle age, death is also increasingly uncommon. But of course, death in old age is not avoidable, and so everyone's dead by 100. Now, this transformation is occurring very rapidly for child mortality. It's what Bill Gates pays attention to. It's what Bill Gates has basically made his personal mission, that while he's alive, you know, he's in good health, he'll be certainly around by 2030. He'd like to see a substantial reduction in child mortality worldwide, and which might be achieved. But you see the difference. China has already reduced child mortality, but still has large gaps in overall attainment till age 70. And that's due to control of chronic diseases, of which tobacco is the most important risk factor to take. And I'll show you some evidence on that. So let's start with just some global numbers of how many, broadly, substance users or abusers there are. So there's about 1.3 billion smokers, about 2 billion drinkers, of which a significant minority are binge drinkers, and something like 200 million illicit drug users. And these are the absolute numbers of deaths annually that occur from those. And I can proudly say that the ex-mayor of Toronto was famous for doing all three of these. So, and if you look at Rob Ford, in fact, at a population level, his biggest risk wasn't from the illicit drugs. In fact, you could add on one more, which is obesity. It was really from his risk from smoking, and I'll show you some evidence from that. So let's start, however, by looking at alcohol. Now, in most populations, smoking kills more than binge alcohol, but Russia is different. And because the Russian drinking patterns involve very much large amounts of vodka, particularly in one go, and you see these ice fishermen out at a lake, they don't look to be doing much fishing, but they certainly are enjoying their early morning vodka. And this, it seems strange to think, well, how can something just like vodka be responsible for big changes in the demographics of a country? But it's absolutely true. And you can look at that by looking at the 40-year trends across countries in mortality before under age 50. And you see, for most countries, we've had this incredible progress, exactly like I showed you. Lower death rates are occurring throughout the world. It's extraordinary progress. So India has come down, China's come down, USA's come down. That little bump here, by the way, was the HIV/AIDS epidemic in parts of the US, but has continued to decline. But by contrast, look at South Africa. It was also in a nice direction, and boom, along comes HIV, and it goes up. Russia is very different because the vodka crisis has dominated the mortality trends in the last 30 or so years. And in Iran, in men, but not in women, there was a huge increase when they went to war with Iraq, but then an incredible progress after, which really relates to basically not being at war. So simple lesson for public health is avoid war, HIV, and vodka in excess. Now, you see this in more particular detail when you compare Russian and UK mortality trends. So at 15 to 54, just men shouldn't die. And you see in UK, there was a steady decline in the death rates. And remember, the UK is not a country you'd say is low drinking. They do have patterns of quite common binge drinking, but nothing like the Russian excess. So the background rates in Russia were high, not because of alcohol, but because of vascular disease and smoking. But the fluctuations over the last three decades have really been due to alcohol, and you see this in the national death rates. So what happened? Well, along comes President Gorbachev, and he can't stand so many drunkards on the streets, so he imposes some restrictions, and overall death rates fall. He gets booted out. And who comes along but Boris Yeltsin? And you all remember Boris Yeltsin. He used to sell his own Yeltsin vodka, which was cheaper than water. And you could buy it in Red Square early in the morning. And along with the economic collapse, a huge increase in the death rates. That came down. And then more recently, when the ruble collapsed, it went back up. So these dramatic fluctuations have been due to really to alcohol-related conditions. And this puzzled epidemiologists because many of us thought, well, look, in moderation, alcohol is supposed to reduce the risk of heart disease. It increases the risk of some, but it reduces the rates of heart disease. But what was happening was that the Russian drinking patterns were so extreme that they were causing things like the heart to stop. And this was studied very nicely by David Zaritsev in Siberia, where he went and interviewed wives of men that had died about what they drank. And if you want the truth about drinking, ask about a Russian drinking, ask their wife after they're dead, and then you'll get the truth. And what they compared were men who drank a bottle of vodka a day on average, and the control group was those that had half a bottle a week. They couldn't find any non-drinking controls, so they had to take controls that had, on average, 20 shots a week are the control groups. And you see this big excess for all the major common causes of death, including heart attacks. So Russia is different in terms of the extreme binge patterns, but most other populations are dominated by tobacco. Okay, well, what about obesity? This is commonly thought as the new tobacco epidemic. And as I'll show you, you can compare the risks. Typical smoking involves a loss of a decade of life, as I'll show you in greater detail. And to get that same loss of life, however, in prospective studies, you have to have quite a large increase in body mass. In my case, it would be adding on 100 pounds more to get a body mass index of around 43. And that means about the same loss of life as being a typical smoker. The more typical levels of obesity in the United States, which are a BMI of around 32, meaning I've got another 50 pounds on, or 40 pounds more, that involves a loss of 3 years of life. So overall, every 2 kilograms more of extra of BMI, or 10% smoking prevalence, reduces life expectancy by 1 year. But overall, the hazards are much greater for smoking than they are for obesity currently, for most common types of obesity. Extreme obesity is different, but modest obesity still is less harmful than smoking. Okay, so what do we know about the contemporary hazards? You often think that, well, we know so much about smoking because it's been studied for the last 50 years, but it's surprising how recent the 21st century evidence became clear, both in men, whom we've known for a long time, but also in women, and also in diverse populations. So this shows that in 6 diverse populations, this very consistent pattern of a loss of about a decade of life lost for smokers, for men and women. And this was summarized really in just in 2012 on the 100th birth centenary of the famous epidemiologist Sir Richard Dahl, one of the first to link smoking and lung cancer. So in Oxford, a group of us met and we compared notes. We had this striking result of very consistent results. And then our study was published thereafter, and this is how Brian Williams summarized it for NBC.
The New England Journal of Medicine, they state flat out smokers lose at least one decade.
Sorry, that didn't work. They say power corrupts and PowerPoint corrupts absolutely. Let me get that back.
And good news and bad news on the smoking front. From the New England Journal of Medicine, they state flat out smokers lose at least one decade of life expectancy over non-smokers on average. The encouraging news here is quitting before 40 reduces the smoking-related death risk by 90%. Compared to continuing on as a smoker.
I love that because it's 66 years of epidemiology in 22 seconds. And everything you need to know about smoking is in what he said. And it is original. He was actually there, and he can proper claim credit for it. So what did we find? Well, we looked at the National Health Interview Study, which is a unique study in the U.S., which links survey data to the National Death Index, which I call the Facebook of death. It's really just a wonderful invention that the U.S. government came in, where you can link individual exposures, get their consent, and then get the death certificate later. And the key finding was very simple. Women who smoke like men die like men. And this means of now about a threefold more likely times risk of dying, comparing similar, otherwise similar smokers versus non-smokers. And you see this for particular conditions, so for all diseases, threefold more common. But for lung cancer now, the risks in women are as extreme as those as in men. And similarly with vascular disease, with chronic respiratory disease, also quite similar. So this finding is important because women were not well documented before. Well, why weren't they? Very simple. Women had not been smoking long enough to increase their risks in a way that you could measure at the population level. So in the 1950s, and early 1960s, the American Cancer Society did a prospective study looking at the lung cancer rates and by smoker, non-smoker, by different ages. And sure enough, there wasn't much of an increase in the lung cancer rates in women that had smoked. And this is, in fact, the tobacco industry had used this argument to say that, well, the Surgeon General's report was wrong because you don't see this effect in women, so it must be something else. But what they knew, but they hid, was that you need to smoke a long time to get the risks. So by 1980s, when women were studied, the risks had increased, but nothing to the level of men, which is now the same for women and men. So if you study the women that have been smoking for 50 years, if you watch that TV show Mad Men, and you see, you know, the smoking prevalence is about 80% on that show, and you see the women smoking from the 60s, and the ones that persisted and did not quit are the ones where only 50 years later you can reliably measure these mature risks. And that's what we were able to do in this study. And the finding is quite remarkable, I believe. So if you look at survival between ages 25 to 80, now no one can guarantee that you can live forever, but survival till age 80 is a reasonable proposition in good health. You see the startling differences in never smokers. 70% of females in the US that are never smokers can expect to reach age 80. And by contrast, 38% only of the smokers can expect to reach age 80. So a huge difference, nearly a twofold difference. And that's adjusting for differences in the fact that women who smoke are lower in education level, they might drink more, they might be more obese. We've adjusted for all of those. And that involves then this decade of life lost. So it's similar for men, in fact, slightly worse, that the probability of reaching age 80 for a never smoker is 61%, but for a smoker, it's 26%. So startling big differences that have happened. Now, what's happened is the death rates in non-smokers have really come down in the U.S. in response to overall improvements into medical care, into things like aspirin and use of statins for those with previous heart attacks, but those benefits are not being seen in non-smokers or in smokers. So the difference between the smokers and non-smokers is increasing. And you see that also in the cessation patterns that although the U.S. should be proud of its records in getting a lot more adults to quit, the ratio varies by gender. Among men at ages 65 to 69, the ratio of current or former smokers to current is about 4-1. But for women, it's only 2-1. So cessation in women still lags behind that of men in the United States. There's still a very important cessation agenda. Now, the good news is because the hazards of smoking are so big, the benefits of quitting are ridiculously good. If you quit by age 30, age range is 25 to 34, but average range of 30, you get back almost the full decade of life lost. Quit by 40, get back 9 years. Quit by 50, get back six. Even quitting by 60 means getting back 4 years of life on average. And this is very similar in the UK study, where you look at the risks of dying versus not by the age of quitting. And those that quit by age 40 still had an increased risk, a 20% excess risk, but you have to compare that to a 200% excess risk of continuing to smoke. And similarly for lung cancer, there is an important residual risk if you quit by 40. But so that's 300% or 230% excess risk, you know, 330 minus 100. But look at the risk of continuing to smoke. I mean, you're looking at about a 2,000% increase. So this is quite relevant because in many populations in Canada and in the U.S., and certainly in this state, you'll have many 40-year-olds who might be thinking, well, it's too late for me. I've smoked my whole life. I started when I was young. I'm not going to get any benefits. It's just not true. Quitting by age 40 in particular leads to a substantial increase in survival. And you see this at the population level where smoking has occurred in large numbers, and the UK is the best example. It went from the highest lung cancer rates in the world to a substantial reduction, and it was able to do so because of reductions in smoking. So before 1960, 42% of all men aged 35 would be dead before age 70, and of that, about half, shown in the shaded part, was due to. Was due to smoking. That's down now in half. 42 is down to about 19%. And the contribution of smoking, which used to account for half of that risk, is down to about a quarter. So substantial progress has occurred also in the United States overall. But this varies by particular ethnic groups and by populations. So one of the things that we've been looking at is what's happening in Mexico, in particularly the high-burden states of Mexico, which are the 13 states right next to the border, and contrasting that to what are the trends in U.S. Hispanic men and women. And overall, the numbers of smoking attributable deaths is declining in both populations, but particularly in U.S. Hispanics. Nice big declines have occurred. And now these are more equal in U.S. Hispanics and the men in high-income or high-burden countries of Mexico are both about 4,000 deaths a year. As a proportion of deaths, they're also similar, about 11% in U.S. Hispanics now to about 9% in the high-burden states. You can't really study all of Mexico because the method that we've applied here really applies to where smoking has been well established. So that's the high-burden northern states of Mexico. Okay, so this framework for knowing that if you really want to know the risks, you have to let and observe populations that have been smoking seriously for a long time is also a good way of understanding what's happening now in developing countries. Now, you have to remember that 95% of the world is not American, and that the major trends that we're talking about in global health very much will be dominated by what happens in large populations such as India and China. So let me show you some data for both. So in China, what has happened is their tobacco epidemic is basically the same as the US, but 40 years later. And they have had a substantial increase in the last decade of the number of cigarettes produced and consumed. And this is where two studies were done that showed the maturing hazards. And what has happened in China is, the conclusion is direct from the Lancet paper by Zheng Minchen, they already have 1 million smoking deaths. It will rise to 2 million by 2030 and 3 million by 2050. And of the 300 million men alive in China that smoke, currently you can expect about 100 million of those will die from smoking. What this means at the population level is that the 1990s estimate showed a modest level, just 12% of all the deaths from in Chinese middle-aged men were due to smoking. That's up to 20%, but higher in urban and rural areas. And in the U.S., it stabilized at about a third. But Hong Kong, which started smoking 20 years earlier than China, is also stabilized at about a third. And so this can safely predict that China will go this route unless there's large-scale cessation. Okay, in India, it's a little bit different. And what we've did under the million death study is do a retrospective study looking at about 220,000 deaths that occurred from diseases and compared to 243,000 controls, and looked at the smoking history. It's a very simple method. Knock on the door, ask if the person who's died in the house recently was a smoker or not, and then complete what's called a verbal autopsy, which is a structured way of getting information on causes of death, and then contrast the smoking patterns. And what we found is that there's already about a million smoking deaths a year in India, and that it varies by the type of tobacco product. So most of the local tobacco consumed in India is the bidi, a small local cigarette. I think some of that actually is being exported to California, at least, or maybe even here. There's very few women that smoke, but they lose 8 years of life. The men who smoke bidis lose 6 years of life, and the men who smoke the Western cigarette lose 10 years of life. So 6, 8, 10, that's the trajectory. Now, that's important because what's happening over the last decade is the cigarette is displacing the bidi. At 15 to 69, the use of cigarettes has doubled, and the use of bidis has come down modestly. And what that means is that the risks are probably going to mature more, and sure enough, we see evidence of that. We contrasted about 10 years apart the risks, and you see in the black the contemporary risk that has increased modestly for all causes, but particularly for respiratory disease and tuberculosis, the contemporary risks are much greater than they were before. So to us, that suggests it's probably an effect of the switching from cigarettes or to cigarettes. So this gives you a framework, because we know now the 21st century risks in mature smoking populations in the US, we can get some upper benchmark of where the epidemic will go. And that's basically involving a threefold higher risk, which you see now in US, UK, you see it in Japanese atomic bomb survivors and in Indian cigarette smokers. Other populations are at earlier stages, but they will reach this plateau unless there is widespread cessation. Okay, so let me turn to one of the obvious questions. It's not good enough to just study smoking. You have to say, well, what can you do about it? Well, what interventions are relevant for, particularly for cessation? The most important is higher taxes, as I will show you. Higher prices, 50% higher price means about 10% of current smokers will quit. And I like to think about it, that what we should be thinking about is 100% higher price means about 20% of current smokers to quit. In Utah, as Nelson took me to a convenience store this morning, and we saw that you've got among the lowest prices of cigarettes in the U.S., the rates, I think the prices are close to 50% lower than they are, for example, in New York. I don't know what they are, let's say, compared to California. But prices are substantially underused in many parts of the world. There's a set of non-price measures, big packet warnings, bans on smoking in public places, which I'll allude to. And I'll talk a little bit about nicotine, electronic nicotine replacement. So why does price work? Well, there's a strong relationship of price and prevalence over time. And you see this in U.S. adults. And this is what's called the price elasticity, which suggests roughly a 10% higher price will mean something like 2 to 4% of current smokers quit, and about 2 to 4% of kids don't start. Interestingly, this price elasticity seems to be something that we've got perhaps programmed into our biology and into our responses, because that downward sloping demand curve, which the economists claim, is seen for other addictive goods. It's been tested in rhesus monkeys and different types of laboratory animals, and you see this downward relationship of the price, which is measured in units of work, and the responsiveness. So it might be something that we're actually hardwired to have this kind of price responsiveness. What that means is that this price responsiveness isn't just something that works in the lab. It actually works in real life. And the best example of that is the surprising case of France. Now, you don't normally think of France as a model for tobacco control, but in fact, they've done surprisingly well. Well, how? They raised the price. So in the U.S., it took the U.S. about 35 years to have consumption from 11 cigarettes per adult per day down to 5 or so. But the French were able to have consumption from 6 cigarettes per adult per day to about 3 in only 15 years. And the reason is that Jacques Chirac, then the French president, raised the tax 5% above inflation every year and announced that he was going to do so. And so taxes went up. The prices rose in real terms. They tripled. And consumption fell substantially. This effect is when Nicolas Sarkozy became the finance minister and then later the president. So there was attenuation there. So substantial decrease. And you see this mirror effect in other populations. You see it in South Africa. Consumption was up. Prices rose. Consumption went down. Now, what's the effect of that? Well, you can study that actually in France by looking at the effects at the population level. And you can do so by looking at lung cancer at younger ages, which is really well diagnosed, and it's due to recent exposure to smoking. And what happened? Well, at 35 to 44, lung cancer in France was going up, in contrast to what was happening in the UK, where because of tobacco control and taxes, lung cancer rates were going down. The female epidemic, which is shown here, was going up but was aborted and was decreasing. And the complete opposite in France up till 1997, going up in men and then going up in women. But look what happened after 1997. Boom. Big decline in lung cancer rates in men, and the female epidemic plateaued. The UK continued to improve. But this big decline was due to mostly to that decreased consumption. They also changed the type of cigarette they were smoking from the high tar to the lower tar, but mostly it was this big change in consumption. So look at this big decrease that occurs because of higher taxes. Okay, but taxes are vastly underused where most smokers of the world live. Of the 1.3 billion smokers in the world, but 80% live in low and middle income countries. And in those populations, the average excise tax, which is the most specific tax, the high tax, is substantially low. It's about a third in low income countries. The average for high income countries is 54%. The US is a little lower than that. Canada, we're up to about 70%. So substantial differences in the world price is really because of the lack of using excise taxes so aggressively. And what we've shown is that if you triple the excise worldwide in many countries, it would double the street price. It would lead to something like 200 million premature deaths avoided, and has a nice feature of also raising about $100 billion more in revenue. So what are the objections to higher taxes? You often hear this from politicians or from economists or the tobacco industry. So the first is job losses. Second is you're going to hit revenue. Third is it's going to hurt the poor and smuggling. And let's deal with each of these in turn. So first of all, job losses is just a myth. It's a very simple economics phenomenon. If you don't spend money on tobacco, you're spending on other goods and services, and that generates employment. It's not that the economy disappears if you're not spending money on tobacco. Revenue losses have been suggested that, well, if you raise the tax, eventually you're going to lead to big declines, but that has not occurred. Now, hurting the poor and smuggling are a little more subtle arguments, and let me go through those. So first on revenue, well, you take a place like Indonesia and you see as they raise tax, what happened to revenue? Just continue to go up. Nowhere in the world is there be still at this stage which the economists call the Laffer curve, or Laffer calls it the Laffer curve. Others haven't actually found the Laffer curve, only he has. And the claim that revenues eventually are going to fall is simply not been borne out for tobacco taxes any place. Even in a high tax environment like in Norway, they went up, revenues continue to go up. What about poverty? Well, this is an important dimension because the poor smoke more and they spend more of their income on tobacco, and they have greater health consequences. So, for example, this is a comparison of the risk of dying, 35 to 69, by education level. And in the United States, in 1996, about a third, or a little over a third, of those with low levels of education were dead before 70, of which something like half was due to smoking. In the poorest, or in the richest, or the most educated group, that was only 20%. And that was in part because smoking was a much smaller contributor. If you remove the effects of smoking, then you would be able to have the inequalities between rich and poor, or educated and not. And that's true in the U.S., and it's also true in other populations. And interestingly, in Canada, which has taken tobacco control seriously, you see that the proportion of deaths due to tobacco has fallen both in the poorest income groups, but also in the richest. Of course, it's lower in the richest, but the absolute gain, which is about a 10% gain in the poorest, is as great as the one in richest. So the poorest aren't being left behind by tobacco control. They're actually getting substantial benefit from this. Now, one of the other arguments is, well, you're whacking the poor by raising taxes on them. They'll have to spend more of their income on tobacco. And that's also not quite true, because the poor are more responsive to price. So they, in fact, quit in greater numbers, and they get a greater health benefit. So if you look by socioeconomic status, this is above the poverty line in the U.S. or below it, the deaths averted from a 50%, this is a model 50% tax hike, accrue in large part to the poorest. A third of the health benefits accrue to the poorest. But of the extra money that, or extra taxes that are raised, how much do the poor bear of that? In fact, they bear only 12%. So because they respond more to prices, it's not necessarily true that the poor bear the burden of higher taxes. You see the same pattern in China. Poor get more of the benefits, they bear less of the marginal tax hike that occurs. Okay, what about smuggling? Well, this is a real concern. And what has happened over time is the estimated levels of smuggling have really risen. They might have peaked sometime in 1997 or so, but they're still substantial and account for something like 6% of smuggled products or tobacco consumption worldwide. Now, you have to remember the tobacco industry has an incentive to smuggle its own products. Why, do you think? Well, A, it scares finance ministers to keeping tax rates low. And secondly, it maintains market share. And the classic example of that is from Canada, where what happened? Well, Canada reduced taxes substantially to try to attempt smuggling, which was occurring across the native reserves between the U.S. and Canada. And when it did so, what happened? Well, the consumption in youth especially rose, and the price fell, and revenues fell. And when this was investigated further, it was effectively the tobacco industry organizing this as a big publicity stunt. You know, they alerted the media to cover all of the back and forth across the river smuggled cigarettes, because they wanted to scare the media. This was their international demonstration project. And thankfully, after this, the Canadian government did the right thing, and they went after the tobacco industry, took them to court, got $1 billion settlement against their complicit involvement in smuggling. And in the most recent budget, they've raised the tax, plus given $100 million more to the police to counter smuggling. And that's the right strategy. Even in the face of modest levels of smuggling, you still reduce consumption and you still raise revenue. And that's the key message in terms of smuggling. Okay, I've talked mostly about taxes, but let me talk about some other interventions. And one of the promising ones is plain packaging. In Australia now, the packages sold can only have this small placement of the brand. The rest of it is all counter-advertising. And this, in some early work, has shown to be effective. Canada has been a real pioneer in using warning labels, which have also been effective. In fact, there are studies in Canada and in South Africa that if you hand a man a pack of Marlboros that has this label, they hand it back and say, give me the one that says it'll kill me. They prefer to be dead than impotent. Okay, let's turn to nicotine replies or electronic nicotine delivery systems, because this is a controversial topic. And in the context, as I've outlined, in the U.S., despite extraordinary progress, you still have a large number of U.S. adults smoking. Many want to quit, but many try, but only about 3 to 4% succeed a year. So that's an understandable problem. So what about electronic cigarettes, or ENDS as they're called now, which is electronic nicotine delivery systems, because there's a variety of not just cigarettes, but vaping products. Well, we know that the toxin levels for the most identified factors, not all of which are known, that cause cancer and other diseases, are much greater in the conventional cigarette than in the electronic cigarette. That's been well studied. If you look at the average ratio, it's startling, between 9 to about 500 of the difference in the levels of these nasty things. But is that enough? Well, perhaps not, because in kids there's evidence of a huge increase in the use of these electronic nicotine delivery systems. In fact, in some populations, it has increased at the younger ages so that it's exceeding smoking. And this has led to a big debate in the community as to, well, is this kids that are never going to become cigarette smokers, or is it just a pathway? And the truth is, we don't know enough evidence on that. But the emerging evidence, and Ken Warner at Michigan is someone that I listen to carefully, suggests that, in fact, there isn't so much evidence of a gateway, that what you see is that the smoking rates are well below the e-cigarette use. Now, the risk, of course, is you get addicted kids, and some will move on to cigarettes, and we simply don't know what to do. We need more evidence. But in the interim, I like to say, well, you know, what's smart regulation? I basically say, let's see what Ken Warner has to say. And he has some sensible suggestions for what could be done for kids. Absolutely prohibit sales to minors. That could be enforced much more seriously. Child-proof packing, prohibit whatever is disguised as marketing to youth. That might be you restrict overall marketing, because it's hard to tell what's targeted for youth or not. And raise the tax modestly at this level. Because the youth are price sensitive, more than the adults, they might respond to slightly higher cost for this. But for adults, it's a little more complicated. And among the steps that Ken has recommended, which I think are sensible, is the FDA needs to be able to license the good products of ENDS much more faster. It takes too long right now. And that's what's leading to so much diversity in the types of vaping products. A big excise tax is probably needed, but that needs to be proportional to the relative risk. So if you say that the harms for cigarettes are way greater, then you raise the tax on that much more than you do on the electronic cigarettes. So you equal out the differences. When Nelson and I went to the convenience store this morning, we saw that the Marlboros were about six, the most expensive brand was Marlboros at around $6.50 or $7. The nicotine replacement were around, or sorry, the electronic cigarettes were around still about $9 or $10 or $12. So you could equal that out, so it creates an incentive for adults to switch. There is a need to try to get the appropriate labeling right. And restricting advertising, I think, would be a reasonable strategy. It's a blunt instrument, but it may be the only thing that works, along with things like improving the performance standards. One of the things that could be done by the FDA is that they could say, well, we want to regulate all nicotine products, so, and that our goal is to reduce the level of nicotines to non-addicting levels, because people get addicted to the nicotine, but it's the other contents in the cigarette that kills them. Restricting vaping to smoke-free areas, I think, is a sensible solution. And one other is to try to make sure that the tobacco industry doesn't own the ENDS industry, because then you've got a conflict where I would try to get someone to maybe start on ENDS, but then switch to cigarettes because that's going to be cheaper for me and more profits for me. Okay. Let me turn briefly to global tobacco control and the politics of this. Now, worldwide, there's about $50 billion of profits a year from cigarettes sales, and there's about 5 million deaths. So that's about $10,000 of profit a year per death. So the tobacco industry is hugely influential because it's profitable, but it's not unbeatable. And the best example of that is just south of you in Mexico. Our good friend Mauricio Hernandez was able to get a 25% tax hike in 2010. He wanted a 10 peso tax hike, but he got 7 peso. And how did he do so? Well, he did some very good analysis. He got the key communities together. Ministry of Finance. Yes. And then he got a good political champion, Senator Saro, who organized protests, and they were able to get this through. And you have to remember, in Mexico, most of Mexico is owned by Carlos Slim, who is one of the world's richest billionaires, and also owns Philip Morris, or is a key stakeholder in Philip Morris. But despite the enormous political interference, they were able to get a tax hike. So to move this along, we have proposed a new Lancet Commission on Global Tobacco Control, which would try to engage ministries of finance. And the goal would be to try to get something like a coordinated tripling of the excise tax in something like 25 countries. Okay, let me conclude again with my four or five key points. One is, on current patterns, there'll be a billion smoking deaths unless large numbers of current smokers quit. Prolonged smokers now can expect to lose a decade of life, but because the risks are so big, the benefits are incredibly useful. Quitting by 40 means you avoid about 90% of that excess risk. And if the world is going to make any serious trajectory changes in the patterns of premature deaths, then smoking has to be taken seriously. If you'd like more information on the things that I've covered, I would encourage you to look at our online course, which is called Death 101. It's University of Toronto and edX platform. It's 5 weeks, about 3 hours of instruction each week, and it covers these key topics that I've outlined for you. It's freely available. In fact, it's running now. We have a recent report on global cancer control done for the disease control priorities, which looks at the feasibility of cancer services, and which tobacco control is prominent. And of course, all of our stuff is on our website. You don't need to buy any of our books. Thank you very much.
So what is the feeling that if you look at India and China, and I don't understand, China, can the provinces increase taxes themselves, or does it have to come as a national dictate? And then is there support from anybody in those countries to move their taxes higher if that's the best way to get people to this country?
Yes, well, the provincial, the provinces own the tobacco industry. It's all state-owned. There's been some interest in raising the taxes, but a real concern has been that, well, this will upset the harmony, meaning you'll have unhappy smokers. But I think there is a slow political interest. Interestingly, the Chinese First Lady, Peng Luan, has been quite outspoken of trying to get people to quit smoking. They have brought in some places now smoke-free laws, which I think will help raise the demand. All these tobacco control interventions work together. If you have smoke-free places and people see the benefits of, going to a restaurant and not having smoke in your face, even if you're a smoker, people like that, then that will increase the demand thing. And why don't we do more on tobacco control? China Tobacco is a complex organization, in part because it's so rich that it provides so much of the money for all parts of the government's working and individual retirement funds and other things. So it'll be a challenge, but I'm more optimistic than I would have been just 5-10 years ago in China. And they also are seeing now the consequences of large numbers of particularly middle-aged men having the consequences of smoking, emphysema and lung cancer in particular. So it's a difficult challenge in China, but I think it's slowly moving in the right direction. In other settings, we've got a little more promise. In India, we've been successful in going to the Ministry of Finance, sharing this evidence. And in the last two budgets, they have raised taxes. And importantly, they raised taxes smartly. They raised it more on the lower end. So it narrows the difference between the most and least expensive brands. So you prevent downward substitution. And that's an important strategy. To come back to the convenience store, the tellers there mentioned that here, what the tobacco industry is doing is they're providing coupons for the lower end cigarettes so that they actually are cheaper. And they're encouraging what the Chinese market has, which is downward substitution. So governments have to be always ahead of the industry strategies. And this price manipulation is obviously one of the things they're doing very well.
All right, thank you. Anyone else have a question? Yeah.
I just wanted to ask a question. It's not quite related to tobacco, but along the same thing. What would you think about something like a fat tax or a beverage tax, taxes on high sugar items? Because I know you talked about it not adversely affecting the poor, but people don't need tobacco, but they do need to eat. So I was just kind of curious what you thought about maybe a fat tax or beverage tax.
In theory, the same price elasticity probably does apply, and there's been some work in out of U.S. and Mexico and others that prices that people do respond to prices for high sugar drinks, but the issue there is of substitution. In particular, that if you raise the tax on one, do they just eat more cookies and decrease the intake of sugary products? Now that being said, I think on regulation of particularly adolescent obesity through things like not having vending machines in schools that are sponsored by the high sugary companies, trying to change the labeling and the broadly the market structure is are important goals. Now, but those would involve much more cooperation with parts of the food industry, not all of it. Because some parts of the food industry are very reticent. You know, their maximum profits are on the supersizing, the really cheap thing. But other parts are more cooperative. So I think you need a different strategy, and it's the evidence where done, which was in Denmark and in Mexico, and I believe they also tried in New York, on the sugar tax or the fat tax, it was not so good, not so clear. So we need more places where we get better evidence, but I think the more promising strategy would be to try to work with the food industry on regulation in particular markets, and absolutely take a very strong line on adolescent and youth exposures. So in Ontario, where I live, what they've done is have a requirement now that the kids have to have a certain amount of exercise to balance the caloric intake from increased sugary drinks.
That's in schools,
yeah.
Yeah, in our schools they're taking out the PE programs, and so we're kind of having the opposite effect and problem that comes with it. Yeah, Ursula.
Hawaii has just raised the smoking age to 21,
yeah.
And I know Utah has started to talk about that also in legislature. I was wondering what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah, Age of initiation in the U.S. Among smokers hasn't shifted much since about 1960s. You know, it came down from the smokers around World War II used to start by age 25, and it dropped substantially to most smokers now starting by age 20. That hasn't changed much. So I'd be reluctant to think that that alone would have an impact on the youth initiation rates. Now, it probably can't hurt, and to the extent where that debate on raising the age of initiation also triggers other debates on saying, well, you know, what do we do to try to get youth smoking down, and taxes would be the single most effective intervention. If it triggers that debate and has some consequence, then I think it's a good thing. But as its own, you want to worry about giving the politicians an off-ramp. They say, oh, look, I raised the smoking age. I've done enough about tobacco. That's just not true. That won't be enough to substantially curb consumption and the increase, or particularly initiation. Things like thinking intelligently about higher taxes, probably an appropriate strategy to discourage vaping. Those kind of approaches, I think, are, you know, it's a more difficult area and not so easy for the politicians to work in, but that's probably where we should be pushing as public health people.
Right back here.
I was just wondering if you've done any research or heard of any research regarding secondhand smoke and if it is detrimental to people as
The WHO has an estimate that they think it's something like 600,000 deaths from secondhand smoke, but I just don't believe that. It says it's about a tenth of the total of cigarettes active smoking, you know, so 5 million from active smoking, 600,000. If you look at the epidemiological evidence carefully, yes, in certain populations, most classic were the stewardesses that worked for many years when smoking was allowed on planes and in closed spaces, or in bar workers that have high levels of exposure, there is an increased effect. But in many populations, that's no longer the case because you don't get that level of exposure. And in other populations, for example, the smoking patterns in China or in India are very much that smoking occurs outside the home, not in the home. So on the whole, I think the effects of passive smoking are been overstated. And I think there's also a little bit, I think we need to be a little bit more honest, I think, in the public health. The main benefit, we use passive smoking as an argument for banning smoking in public places. But we should, I think, be honest. The main benefit of a ban on smoking in public places is that it substantially raises the quit rates. And you can imagine, right? I mean, on a day like this, if you have to, you can smoke in your office, but if you have to go outside and if you ever have to stand, you know, 5 meters away from the building, you're much more likely to quit. So we should come clean and say that the main benefit is to help smokers quit. And if you look at the effects of the ban on smoking in public places, it has led to a big increase in cessation at younger ages, and that in turn has contributed to a big decline in heart attack admissions in many populations. So there are real effects, but that's from protecting the smoker themselves, not from the non-smoker.
I know we're keeping him over. We have a couple more questions. Why don't we take the last two hands that came up, and then we'll let him go.
What we know is that the constituents in vaping products, or ends more broadly, they vary incredibly. But for the most part, the levels and the way that they're delivered are less toxic than the cigarette. That, I think, is well established. Now, there's all sorts of issues there about some kind of... There's some vaping products might actually be dangerous because they're poorly designed and they can explode, all of those things. Those are product safety issues. But on the whole, we know that the constituents in vaping products are less harmful than the cigarette. But that's not the debate. The big debate is, does it actually lead to, is it a gateway? In other words, you're attracting kids that wouldn't have even thought about cigarette smoking, and now because vaping is cool, they do vaping, and then later they switch to cigarettes. That's the big concern. There are people who think that, well, any kind of addiction is bad, and just being on a vaping product for long term, being addicted is bad. Now, I take the view that, look, what we should be concerned about is the consequences, the public health consequences of the behaviors. And we don't have enough long-term evidence, but we probably think that if that is the, you know, if you get a cohort of people who vape their whole life, their risks we know are going to be lower. They're not zero. They're not the same as non-vapers, but they're going to be much, much lower. So the alternative is, well, if they were switching to cigarettes, they'd be certainly worse off. We just don't have enough evidence. We need many more places to try to collect this and put it together in a way that informs policy. But we don't right now.
Okay. We had one last question back here.
I was just curious, you mentioned the smuggling issue that takes place. Is there any type of international organization, the WHO, have any type of agency that polices that or watches that, or does it fall to individual states to maintain that?
Yeah. What we've done is work with the regional economic and tax agencies. So some of it is, for example, in the European Commission, they have a smuggling office. Each country has the equivalent of the whoever's enforcing the customs. The key thing about smuggling to note is that the effects of price on smuggling aren't so much that, oh, well, you know, it's cheaper in Utah, let's just drive across and get some. That does occur, but the amount that I'll buy might be a small number. The big smuggling occurs when criminal networks get into getting entire trucks and then filling them up with low-tax cigarettes and taking them high-tax cigarettes. Now, like any major crime operation, you don't do that alone. You need a vast structure. So the key thing to counter smuggling is to go after the criminality and the organized networks. And there are incredible successes. Spain, for example, went after the criminalized networks, and also Turkey. They didn't focus on the street sales. They focused on who's actually bringing this in. And when they did, they saw a big reduction in the smuggled brands. So, and that's the right strategy. And what was nice about the Canadian finance minister's tax hike is he put $100 million into the police's hands to go after the criminal networks. And that's the right response. And the same model could apply to the U.S.
What a wealth of knowledge. Did you want to... Oh, okay. I think we should give him another round of applause. We really appreciate you coming and sharing your wealth of information with us.